Making a life worth living and retirement worth having is really about having all the right people in our lives at the time that we need them to be. You see, when someone portrays something they're not, it's one thing. When they tell us that we're not worthy, that's another thing. When we're looking for how to make a life worth living and a retirement worth having, we have to have people in our lives, in our career sets, and in our corner to help us to see our skills, to exercise our talents, and to literally be that cheerleading squad that we sometimes need in life when we're going through rough times. Those folks are what we call our soul keepers. Soul keeping is something I talk about literally in my book. Soul keeping means that we're interested in the soul that God put in someone, and we're trying to help them to go as far in life as they possibly can, because that is what the Lord in heaven would want us to do. When we don't think about what it looks like to others to sit there and to think about our life and to not really reach out to other people, it's not the same. You see, on a holiday, people are usually in their own personal zone. They're in their zone with their family, they're in their zone with their closest of friends, and they're literally looking at, how do I make a life worth living and a retirement worth having so I can celebrate the holidays in ways that make sense to me? In our lives, we have lots of things we have to accomplish. We have to accomplish a lot of different things. But in reality, when we're looking at how do I make a life worth living, how do I make that retirement worth having, we have to look at who are the people in our lives. You see, it's the people in our lives that teach us things. When life doesn't go well, we might have to stop and think, did I make a mistake in who I was supposed to be spending my time with? Did I literally put the wrong people in my life that so angered the Lord that He decided to make us have a difficulty? To learn a lesson about who's supposed to be in our life and who we are supposed to let go of in the easiest possible way. But sometimes we hold on to people. We hold on to them, we stranglehold them, and we literally want to keep them as close as we can to us. That's not really fair, because at the present moment it's starting to rain and I'm going to have to go in. But in reality, we have to make a life worth living for other people. We have to make a life worth living that seems real and appropriate to the people in our lives. The people in our lives are those that really make a difference for us. They're the people that stop and say, hey, looks like you're doing something there. What is it that you're doing? Or, hey, looks like you make something. I'd like to buy one of those because I think it'd be supportive of what you're trying to accomplish. Or, hey, I understand you're having a struggle and we've got this extra guest room, or we've got an extra sofa. Would you like to lounge there for a little while to get out of the rain, to get out of the snow, to get out of the freezing cold? But mostly people go on in their lives and they're not thinking about how God puts people on their path, and they don't even see them. They walk right by them and they don't even acknowledge they exist. Now, I've done that a few times, but then I realized that God was saying, don't talk to that person. I've now discovered why they're saying that, because that person's a liar. That person produces a lie and gives information to people and literally does not think about the impact it makes on other folks. Now, it doesn't seem right for a reporter to say that, right? Or am I supposed to report on what I observe? You see, when I report on what I observe, I literally get hit. I get hit by family, I get hit by friends, I get hit by colleagues, I get hit by people in the world who have authorities. And I have to sit there and go, why is that? Why are they so free of their time that they can pay so much attention to me, but they're not seeing the illness in the world of the people who are doing the ill-willed things? I literally just walked down to a restaurant that was telling me they weren't open till 11 o'clock. There was a lot of ways that young man of representing that international firm could have told me. He could have said, hey, welcome to our restaurant. I'm so glad you're here. Our challenge right now is that we're not open yet. You've got a couple options. You literally could step out the door and go on your way and come back to us when we're open, or you're welcome to sit here out of the cold and the freezing rain that's coming and just be a guest until we're ready to serve you. What do you think? That would have been the appropriate way for someone of that type of a company to have talked to me. Instead, that individual sort of accosted me to tell me that they weren't open yet and I couldn't be there. You see, that felt more militant, that felt more security-oriented, and that certainly didn't feel like the spirit of Christmas that everybody's supposed to be having in their souls. When they see someone doing something, when they see someone working, they really should allow them that right to do that individual performance. They shouldn't be getting onto their computers whenever I go to a particular type of restaurant. I literally get hacked by some young teenager who hasn't understood the law, or some mentoring-oriented mom who's behind the counters. And I've sort of made an observation of places that I go, of the people who show up on duty when I'm there, but also of what happens to my computer when I'm literally there. Now, there's also people outside of the building that can access that internet connection, and they might be monkeying around with my lawful rights to make phone calls. That is, in effect, something that they used to do in Stalingrad, that they would interfere with people's telephones, that they would monitor what they were doing, and they would really interfere with people's right to make a life worth living and retirement worth having. But today we're celebrating the holidays. We're outside of Starbucks. It's really quite busy for a holiday, and it's amazing that people will not stop and say hello, but they'll go in for that cup of joe and literally just be beholden to that caffeine fix that they have. Now, I'm sort of making light and fun of the reality of people needing coffee in the morning and needing good quality coffee. But in truth, there's people all around them as they walk into those places, and I wonder, how many people are they missing because they didn't take the time to talk to someone? How many opportunities has God put on their path within a very simple place, like a coffee shop, that openly could have changed their life, or they could have changed someone else's life, but they don't see it because they've got that cup of joe in their hand and they literally don't get it. You see, the world is about people. It's not about the products that we buy. It's not about the things that we put into our beings. It's about discovering who needs what in this world. It's really about taking opportunities that literally are enforced in front of us every single day. It's also about extending grace. You see, there's a lot of grace that can be extended in the world, but people don't really do that. I literally was supposed to be picked up by a sister yesterday. The problem is she ended up in the hospital. Did any other sibling decide to come and get me? No. So what did I do? I stayed outside freezing my ass off outside of a company where the employee told me they'd be open tomorrow. They weren't open today. It was a complete and total lie by that employee telling me that they were going to open at 6 in the morning. Luckily, I have my own resources to know what to do and where to go. But in reality, I still froze outside because I had no other sibling willing, able to simply say, hey, this is what's really going on. Here's the text message, or hey, let's go find him. You see, that's the amazing thing about family is we have family who love us for who we are. We have family who love us for what we are. And then we have family who care about whether or not we're freezing in the winter's cold through the night or not. The people who don't care are obviously those. My own mother didn't even bother to call and wish me happy holidays, but that's okay. She's constantly in some sort of tizzy about my life, and it's not really her lawful right to be. There are other people that sort of dog me and hound me, literally when I make a reach out to try and say, hey, are you mature enough now to forgive me? Are you wise enough now to get why God put us on each other's path? Have you understood why it's not proper to voyeur on people's lives and snitch on what they do and tell other people? Have you figured that out yet, people? I don't know. You see, I can be a matter-of-fact journalist like I often am, or I can be a love-toting, peace-oriented monkey like a lot of people are in other parts of the nation, because they're allowed to be. They're allowed to be all they can become, all they can achieve, but there's a lot of poverty there too. It's the holiday time, and I literally approached a woman who's almost an hour early for her job, allegedly, but she couldn't help me. She couldn't produce enough care on behalf of that company that is known for helping people to open the door and allow me to go in and be out of the cold. She also couldn't produce enough care to allow me to have one morsel of food, and it's Christmas. You see, when we represent a company, such as the gas stations or the other small companies that decide to stay open and honor people's patronage on the holidays, we really need to think about who are we putting in that position. Yeah, we might put the people who don't have any family, but we might also realize that those people without family really might not be the best representatives for us on a day that tends to be about family. Whether it's our birth family, whether it's our extended family, or whether it's literally about the people and the family that we put in our lives because God literally says, it's time now. It's time to forgive. It's time to extend grace. It's time to get out of this man's business. It's time to just be what you're supposed to be, a loving, caring, interested individual. Not trying to run some game, not trying to play some control, not trying to steal a property that's bequeathed, and not trying to monkey with someone's other individual rights as an American in this land. But where are those people? Where are those people that really used to be out on Christmas, singing carols, ringing bells, extending the holiday cheer to people in need? You see, people in need go to the store. I've literally watched tons of people try to go to Walmart today, to only discover that it's not open or it may not be open till much later. Other stores have decided to celebrate the holidays, and it's perfectly fine, but there still needs to be a place or two that people can go who don't have those celebratory opportunities to be out of the cold and to be welcomed and enfolded. What's absolutely amazing to me is that there seems to be no churches open on Christmas, and we celebrate Christ's birth. Now, it might have been because they didn't feel like there was enough people to warrant turning on the electricity, but considering they are a one day a week, for the most part, maybe 2 day a week type of business in a huge building, the very least thing they could do would be open a soup kitchen or something on Christmas. to celebrate Christ's birth, to help people in need, and to literally get out of the way of God. You see, God is in people all the time, but oftentimes they miss what they're supposed to be doing because they're too busy in their own lives not to notice somebody in their other life. And then they miss the opportunity to become more. They miss the opportunity to learn something. They miss the opportunity to go, gosh, God is leading me to feel like this. But then what happens? The Satan force comes in and says, no, you don't want to help that person. No, let's let them struggle. No, let's just teach them a lesson. Really? Is that what you really think God put you on the planet to do, is teach people lessons? Or did God put people on the planet to love one another, to serve one another, and help everyone go higher in life? You see, love is what Jesus was preaching about. The Prince of Peace is literally what he's talked about. But openly, people just go on with their day. They don't think about their life. They don't think about how they can interact with other people. They literally just think that cup of Joe is more important than any other Joe on the planet. And that's a shame. That's the little shame of sitting outside a place like this. What's the other shame is that every time I go in this place, I literally have someone hacking my computer. I find it offensive. If it's a personal attack, that's one thing. If it's something that employees do all the time because a person didn't jump to buy a product, that's a problem. You see, in life, we're supposed to be creating customers for life. We have to create customers for life for Jesus. We have to create customers for life for God. We have to create customers for life for the angels. And we literally have to create customers for life in everything we do. So that when we drive a particular truck, we're not the ill-willed representative of that truck. If we drive a fancy car, we're not that selfish, arrogant driver of that vehicle. Because our brands are what we put on us. But more importantly, our business brand, our personal brand, is what we say, what we do, and how we interact with other people. See, it's apparently allegedly okay for this one guy named Paul to go in and be there all day long, and maybe he can pay for his food. But it's not okay for someone else to go in and go, gosh, I'm in the midst of struggle, and I really need to be online to do a few things for my life and get a new job in the new year and survive these holidays, and openly, that's okay. But where are people supposed to go when they lose everything? Downtown, where they're overpopulated and there's no place to be safe? You see, that's the problem with the forces in the world, is that they forget who they represent. Who they really represent are the politicians in this community. Their job is supposed to be customer service all the way. It's supposed to be about, I have to remember that I represent a leader of this community. I am literally employed by that leader. And if I say the wrong thing, if I lie to someone, if I do the wrong thing, then I have just failed the community. Not only the leader who put me in place or my boss, but I've literally failed the community that is supposed to be about honesty, integrity, and a welcome and hospitality for all people. You see, the minute that a community starts to police people and decide who and what they want and who and what they don't like and in a community, it's a slippery slope. It means even that person can be policed right out of a community. You see, it's the officers that fail us in life that create the destruction in the world. Because people don't like them, so they go after them. We've seen a lot of that in the news, and that's a sad thing. We have military people who are so disregarded. I simply was wearing my dad's shirt. It's one of the couple things that I actually received from his passing. And I wore it around. Maybe one person tried to honor me for my service. I said, oh no, this is my father's shirt. It's kind of you to say, but really, I'm just honoring my dad and wearing it. But everybody else pretty much ignored me. Now, there was a handful of people along my journeys that I list on my website, provided that I can keep it, that really have helped me through this homelessness, much more than any person in my entire family, in truth. Now, I have a sister that's been generous, but I have no way to know whether or not she's really in the hospital, or she just thought she'd strand me outside because she didn't like the fact that I could tell that her neighbors were going into my property in her house and stealing my stuff. They stole the presidential coin set that my father bequeathed me. They took legal documents from my bags. Or maybe it was her and she's trying to cover it up. It's hard to say. You see, today in this world, we have people who lie because they think they have the right to lie. Then we have people in this world who decide not to disclose because it's their right not to disclose private information. But then there are people in this world who just sort of monkey around, make intimate relationships with other people, have really deep conversations, and then just pick up and walk away. Like, oh well, that was fun, I'm done. That is not the life of the Lord. That is certainly isn't the way that Jesus prepared himself, and it's certainly now how he held his apostles and the creed that he is about. The Jesus Creed is a wonderful book. You should consider reading it. But openly, I'm not getting on a God kick. I'm saying, where's the God in your life? Is the God in your life only interested in what your kids open at Christmas? Or are you more interested in helping someone who really is in need? You see, there's all sorts of people in this world. The reality is, you might be missing out on the gem employee because you weren't too busy doing your thing. You might be missing out on the people who are harming others in your company because you're too socially involved with them. It's a fine line, absolutely, of knowing who's who and what's what. But here's what I do know, that people in this land need more help in this world than they ever get from one person. And the truth is, unless you're out there really thinking about how would God want me to help other people that I cross paths with every single day, that's what makes the difference between a peaceful world, a loving world, and one that's full of war, hate, and other things. Now, this has been Blake Ensign of Blaze Communications LLC saying, hey, thanks for listening. Happy holidays. And I hope something resonates with you in your soul of what I've shared in this message today. God be with you.